This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
If I told you half the things I've heard about this Jabba the Hutt, you'd probably shock me.
I'm here, Jabba.
Been waiting.
Hello, Star Wars fans, and you are all very welcome along to episode 27 of Blabba the Hutt.
The illustrious Jabba bids you welcome and will gladly pay you the reward of 25,000.
So the only thing that you can tell me is that I will find Jabba at Jabba's palace.
Now, episode 27 is going to be an interesting episode because we are going to talk about my motherland, the place where I grew up, Ireland. Ireland has become a really important place within the Star Wars galaxy, and as anybody who has encountered me anytime since the release of The Force Awakens, I am very, very proud and very excited to see what Star Wars can take from Ireland. But anybody who has met me also knows that I could talk about Ireland and Star Wars all day long. So what we decided to do was we were going to change things up a little bit, and Kate, who has experienced Ireland firsthand, is going to talk about Star Wars and Ireland. How are you, Kate?
Hi, I'm good. How are
Cade
you?
Cade Mila Falcha. So, Kate, you're taking the reins for episode 27 of Blabba the Hutt. Are you, how are you feeling about that?
It's going to be interesting.
Because we've had some Kate solo episodes, but this is the first time that I'm handing the mic over to Kate Dubinko.
Yeah, it's kind
to
of
talk
weird.
About... It's like us doing a episode on the Arizona desert, you know.
Well, maybe we'll have to do that next.
We may have. Well, I might have to make a trip out first. That's
there
the only
go.
Thing.
We'll you, go you've visit got to step. Tatooine filming sites.
That's exactly it. Yeah, you've got to step ahead of me in that you've actually been to the Emerald Isle. How are you, yep. Anyway?
Doing pretty good.
Yeah, it's good to have regular programming back.
Yep.
It's been totally crazy. And, like, we've got so much banked by way of recording.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like, we've so many great interviews from Celebration. We've sucked so many interviews that we're going to hear today on your Irish episode of Blabba the Hutt. Tell us a little bit. Go on. I'm going to hand the reins over to you now, Kate. This is your episode.
So for this episode, you basically covered it already, but it'll be my perspective of Ireland, both as like a first-timer in Ireland and as a Star Wars fan, so should be pretty interesting stuff.
Should be. I hope it hasn't, or maybe it has changed quite a bit, your perspective and your overview of Ireland as a country and as a Star Wars destination.
Nothing bad.
No, absolutely not. No, what I'm saying is that, like, the American perception of Ireland can sometimes be a bit diddly-eye, which is like, you know, we're all little green leprechauns running around the place. I think, Kate, can you confirm that? Did you see any leprechauns?
That was exactly my experience.
Hold on, sorry. I just have to adjust my pot of gold that I'm sitting on here. It's a little bit uncomfortable.
Exactly. I mean, like in Dublin, there was like the people dressed up as leprechauns and stuff like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Well, they're gonna capitalize on tourism, unfortunately. You know.
But yeah, I mean, it was awesome. It's so beautiful over there. But we'll get into that later on in the show. Why don't we go ahead and start with some news?
Yeah, go with it.
So our big story, if you don't follow us on Twitter or Facebook, is that we've been nominated for another award.
Yay!
Tell us about this award. It is actually Irish related as well.
Yeah. So in keeping with the theme here today, we have been nominated within the film and TV category for Best Blog in Ireland at the Irish Blog Awards. Now, this Blog Awards actually is kind of a big deal in that it's got a, you know, quite a big sponsorship. It's sponsored by Littlewoods, which are like a department. I think it's an online department kind of store, kind of like a, I don't know, like a, what do you have over there? Like a big Amazon? Department store? No, but it's like an online version of like a big department store that sells clothes and
like Macy's
perfume
or
and
something?
Macy's, exactly, yeah. But we've been nominated within the film and TV blog area of that of this award, which is
shortest.
Incredible. Like, yeah, first of all, we made the long list, which had about 20 odd blogs on it, and now we've hit the last. I think it's the last 8 or 10 that we're into now. I'm excited about this mostly, Kate, because I think we offer a slightly different angle to the film and TV blogosphere, insofar as we're very focused in our effort. You know, we're not going to talk about, you know, the Avengers or Suicide Squad, or, you know, our core is Star Wars, and, you know, we talk very clearly about nothing but Star Wars. And even at that, and I think what gives us an edge on this is that we talk about Irish Star Wars a lot as well,
mm-hmm.
you know, which is obviously very relevant to the Irish audience. And this is why I think that we have a great opportunity here to really put our best foot forward.
Awesome. So how can people help?
The best way to do it, I mean, you can go to the Irish Blog Awards website, but the best way you can do it is if you go to blabbathehutt.net, there's a the top story you'll see on the website is the call to action, essentially, which is that we want you to come read a little bit about the awards themselves, and then there's a big link there which says click to vote for Blabba the Hutt. Now, Kate, what I will tell you is that though we're asking people to vote, and I really, really hope people will, and I really want the Star Wars community to get behind us here, and, you know, to have Star Wars at the top of a whole film and TV category would be amazing, mm-hmm. but this award show isn't all about votes, which is amazing, because I cannot stand the popularity contest that happens with a lot of awards and you know, these kind of category, you've got to get all your mates to come and vote for you, and it just becomes a popularity contest over anything else.
Mm-hmm.
Only 20% of the marking for this award will be done via public vote. The rest of it is all judging panels, so they're going to judge the look of the site, they're going to judge the content. You know, they're going to, I presume, look at our social channels and kind of judge it as a whole package rather than just who has the most friends or who can annoy the most people. Do you know? So, I mean, I think that's fair, to be honest with you.
Definitely.
I do think our readers and our listeners should be able to vote for mm-hmm. our blog. And I mean, like, okay, we don't ask for anything. We don't, you know, we don't do anything by way of, you know, asking people for money or, you know. We're just happy to create this content each week and hope that people enjoy it. And mm-hmm. the only thing that we ever really ask in return is things like this, where we want to be recognized. We want to try and push this show to places that it's never been before. And this is just a way for us to be able to do it. You know, if we were able to, at the end of this month, turn around and say, put a little badge on the Facebook or on the Twitter, mm-hmm. or on the website itself, just saying, you know, voted best TV and film blog in the Irish Blog Awards 2016, you know, that gives us a certain credibility
mm-hmm.
that'll allow us to push further and do bigger and better things and get better interviews, although I think we've done pretty good so far. You know, it's about the constant evolution of what is Blabba the Hutt, you know, and I think we've had a rocking first year, so, you know, here's a great way to start our second.
Yeah, totally. When do they announce the winners?
The actual winners are announced. You get this, Kate? You might have to buy another flight over to Ireland. There's an actual award ceremony.
Oh, no way.
Which is in early September. Yeah, so that's in early September. And I haven't decided yet whether we're going to, you know, because you got to buy tickets. So it's a full gala. Now, they're doing a cool circus theme. So it's actually being held in a circus tent, which is quite cool. Yeah, it's awesome. Like, I haven't decided yet because obviously there's a monetary expense against mm-hmm. it. It's not huge, but at the same time, if I feel that we've got a really good chance of winning this, then I'm definitely going to go. So that's kind of, you know, that's another right. reason why we want people to vote for us, because to give us that best chance for us to actually win on the night. But that is in early September. But voting for the 20% marks. That closes on the 24th of August, which I believe is Tuesday, I think, is it?
Next week.
Yeah.
So probably by the time this airs.
Yeah, so if you voted for us, thank you very much. If this comes out before the 24th, we would be very grateful if you could pop onto Blabba The Hutt, follow all the links, and give us your vote.
Cool.
It'd be cool, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would be amazing. So speaking of starting off Blabba Year 2 on an awesome note, do you want to just talk a little bit about Dublin Comic Con?
So Dublin Comic Con was kind of the end of what I'm seeing as the celebration of the first year of Blabba. So obviously we had our 1 year anniversary in July, just in and around the time of Celebration, which was very appropriately marked with Blabba Live at Celebration Europe, which is amazing. Then following that, we got the news of the long list for this Irish Web Awards. Then we also got the news that we were shortlisted for, the long list for the Irish Blog Awards. Then we found out that we got the long list for the Irish Web Awards as well. And then we got
two separate ones?
There's two separate ones, yeah.
What?
Yeah.
I didn't even realize that.
Now, they're slightly different in that one is specifically about blogs, and then the other one is about the web. You know, so it's about websites. It's about, there's both the commercial and a personal element to it. But let's not worry about that yet, because we're not not quite as deep into it as we are with the Irish Blog Awards.
Oh, okay.
But then we had Dublin Comic Con, which was a couple of weekends ago, and we were asked to do another live panel, you know, pretty quickly after Celebration. So we've got two live shows under our belt now, which is incredible. But it was just such a nice way to round out the whole 1 year experience and the celebration that was 1 year of Blabba The Hutt.
Yeah.
So what we did for that one was unfortunately you weren't able to attend. It was very sad. I felt, you know, it was weird going solo, I'm not gonna lie. But thankfully we enlisted the help of Matt O'Brien and Gary O'Toole, who you would have heard on episode 26, our Rogue One Roundtable, who are two very knowledgeable, very capable Star Wars fans to fill in the gaps. So we talked extensively and entirely about Star Wars comics, which I'm sure you'll agree right now, Darth Vader is like absolutely killing it.
That it's like one of the issues 24. I just picked that up last week. It was crazy.
It's so good. If for anybody listening, if you have not read the latest arc of Darth Vader comic, now it's coming to an end. There's one or two more issues, I think.
Oh wow.
And it's coming like the whole, this is going to be the end of the Darth Vader line.
Oh wow.
It has been incredible. This is just like it's the best of the best right now.
It goes
now.
So fast, like in a good way.
But the pace, and that's what I like about it. Yeah. It's they rely quite heavily on the actual visuals rather than the dialogue, which I like about it. You know, and the visuals carry it really, really nicely. Yes. And it's great. It's great to learn about Silo 5, who is it Silo 4 or Silo 5? Who basically we find out was the creator of the suit that Darth Vader is encapsulated in. But yeah, no, so Dublin Comic Con was incredible, and it was a really nice way to round out everything. And again, I know I said it on social, I said it here, and I said it on the day, which is just, look, thank you to everybody who came out. We were up against a couple of big panels. We were up against the guy who created the Teenage Ninja Mutant Turtles.
What?
Yeah. And then we were also up against another Irish podcast called Storybreakers. Great guys. Mm-hmm. Super, super cool guys. You know, so that was two big panels to be up against. So, you know, literally from the bottom of my heart, thank you to everybody who came out to see us.
It seemed like there was a really great response from people, too. Like, a lot of people might not have been too familiar with the comics, and it seems like they got a really good education.
Yeah, well, I mean, we're going to actually release the audio from the episode. It's just I didn't want to release Celebration and Dublin Comic Con too close together, because obviously there was so much still happening in the Star Wars world that we needed to cover. But what you'll hear when you actually listen to the episode is, you know, I asked the crowd, I was like, does anybody read the Star Wars comics? And nobody in the room was actually reading the new line of Star Wars canon, which is crazy that, you know, now I kind of promoted the panel as the only opportunity in Dublin Comic Con to go and actually talk Star Wars. I didn't necessarily say it was definitely going to be comics. But what happened then after was amazing, which is like people were tweeting us saying, oh, I just picked up, you know, the first arc of Darth Vader. I just picked up Shattered Empire, you know, or even people were like coming up to me saying, will you write down what I need to read? Do you know?
Cool.
So, I mean, it was great to be able to introduce these people. You know, they were obviously all very big Star Wars fans because they had all these questions. And to be able to say, look, if you want to fill in the gap about, let's say, you know, maybe... do you think Poe is force sensitive? We'll go read Shattered Empire. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? Do you want to learn about a little bit more about Han Solo? Then go read, you know, the first arc of Star Wars where we're introduced to Sana Solo. Like, you know what I mean? There was loads of these, like, kind of, it was very, very cool. And, you know, great reaction. And I think people enjoyed it.
Awesome. Well, good job, guys.
Yeah. Yeah. Good. Go us. Go Team Blabba. I was very, can I just say also, I was very, very proud of the lads. You know, they stepped up to the plate immensely. And, you know, I had absolutely no reason to believe that they wouldn't. But, you know, they put on a great show and I was completely confident in everything that they were saying. So big shout out to the boys for that.
Awesome.
Cool.
All right. So moving on, we talked about it a little bit in our last episode about the passing of Kenny Baker. So that was very sad and... we're all just still really sad about that. But one good thing that came from that was all the awesome tributes that we've seen from people who were closest to him and even just like regular fans like us. What were some of your favorite tributes that you saw for Kenny Baker?
Well, I mean, what I loved about Kenny, the tributes poured out to Kenny, was that it was this unified conversation that all of our original trilogy characters were having, do you know? I do think visually what stood out most was Mark's, just because I think the two of them spent so much time on set together. Mm. You know, the film really shows the bond that grows from the moment he cleans R2 to the, you know, right through to the end of the original trilogy. You know, I think there's a special bond there between Luke Skywalker and R2. Like, you know, he saves his butt so many times in the X-Wing, and, you know, he's always just been this character. So, I mean, I think Mark's tribute, which is goodbye, Kenny Baker, a lifelong loyal friend. I loved his optimism and his determination. He was the droid I was looking for. I mean, it says everything. I've met Kenny and it says everything. Like, he was a very optimistic and a very loyal person. Like, you know, everything he talked about, he always talked so highly about it. Working with people, like, you know, there was nobody on the set, even though there was always, you know, the reported tiffs that he had with Anthony Daniels. You know, he never ever spoke ill of anybody. And I think, you know, when you look at all the things that he's done, he's been a musician, he's been an actor, you know, he's really, his determination just shines through. And I think Mark has Kenny Baker summed up in 140 characters in two images. Like, you know, I think his is spot on. What about you?
I liked, on the actual article on StarWars.com, they had a quote from George Lucas. He says, Kenny Baker was a real gentleman and as well as an incredible trooper who always worked hard under difficult circumstances. And that actually goes along. I'd sent you a message earlier this week. I started this book called Cinema Alchemist by Roger Christian. So he's like the set dresser for the original Star Wars movies. And so it's really interesting because he goes into more detail about that, how difficult of a job it actually was for him and how uncomfortable he was inside of that, the casing that's R2-D2. And I never really realized that before. So kudos to Kenny for being such a trooper.
I think one thing that all of these, I mean, like, we've had tributes from Kathy Kennedy, we've had tributes from George Lucas, Peter Mayhew, you know, I mean, what all of these tributes have said, and, you know, tell me if you didn't get this, but it was all about how R2-D2 obviously visually is very strong, but he's nothing without the life that Kenny Baker brought through, you know, and you'll always hear about actors who have to wear masks or have to, like, get into suits about how, you know, when you are watching a film, a lot about what you know about this character is based on what they do with their face and the visuals and their mm-hmm. eyes and their, you know, once you put a mask on or once you get into some kind of a costume,
mm-hmm.
it's a whole different level of acting. Do you know what I mean? And then I think there's another level, which is the level that Kenny Baker acted in. You know,
yeah.
he wasn't just in a costume. He was in a tin cylinder. Do you know? I mean, he had to bring R2's character through by shaking, mm-hmm. by turning. And I mean, I don't know if you ever heard it, but if you ever watch any of the making of, he's sitting in the casing of R2 making the noises. He's there going boop, 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 boop. You know what I mean? He's actually bringing this, you know, bin. What was it? Literally, it's a bin before we know it as R2 to life.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Imagine the first day on set. Okay, now R2-D2 is not a character at this point. You know, there's no legacy. There's no culture there already. And George Lucas says, yep, that's what you're sitting in. And Kenny Baker's looking at him going, that. But that's just looks like a dustbin. Yeah, yeah.
It was actually really interesting in the book because Roger Christian was talking about how they were looking for someone. And I guess, like, around that same time, Kenny had auditioned with a friend of his for, like, this, like, America's Got Talent or, like, mm-hmm. Britain's Got Talent type show. And, like, they were, like, in the semifinals or something. It was, like, crazy. I never
knew that. That's it. Like, I don't know much about his... Because he had a big musical kind of element as well.
Book, like, it's so good. Because they talk about actually building R2 around Kenny, like, once they finally chose him, you know? It's really interesting.
Okay, no, I definitely... Cinema Alchemist, is it?
Yeah, we need to get him on the show, too.
Yeah, we'll try and get Roger on the show, because I think it sounds like a very interesting book. I actually have a couple of Audible credits that I'll use to pick that up.
Sweet.
Kate...
Yes.
As the queen of droids, mm-hmm. and as obviously a huge R2 advocate.
Yes.
What was it like when you heard that noise, or when you heard that news?
It just crushed me. I was like, oh man. Especially since, like, I never got a chance to meet him. It was so sad. Mm.
Like. When you hear of a celebrity death, like this year for me, like you had David Bowie, you know, you've had so many, actually Prince. 2016 as a year has been crap, you know. I mean, obviously Kenny Baker as a person is one thing, and it's obviously terrible and whatnot, but for you who had such affection for R2-D2, was it especially hard because it was two impacts almost?
Yeah, I mean, it was really sad, too, just kind of thinking of R2 in the new trilogy.
Mm-hmm.
How, like, he's getting old in the movies, too. It's like, what are they going to do with him in the future?
And he's definitely slowed down. And actually, that's a really good segue, because I was only reading during the week about how Kenny Baker, even, obviously, as he got older, I mean, dwarfism comes with its health issues and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And whereas people like Peter Mayhew, actually, it was interesting on just a segue, Peter Mayhew talked about how they shared a lot of time talking about their health issues, because people with, you know, people who are very tall and people who are very small actually share a lot of the same
mm-hmm.
issues, both, you know, from a health perspective and then also from a life perspective.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was quite nice. But what Kenny Baker said was that, like, as the advent of CGI came in, obviously his role as R2, because, I mean, even when we look at the prequels, mm-hmm. R2 was, you know, there was a lot of CGI involved there. That's even a sad moment when almost, like, obviously he was still credited as R2-D2, but I mean, you know, it's almost like the requirement for his life and his spirit, you know, decreased.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just a sad thing to see,
mm-hmm.
but at the same time, we know that everything that was in the prequels and everything that was in the new, in mm-hmm. The Force Awakens was based on everything that he had brought through. And do you think that in the new films, in episode 8 and 9, will they go completely animatronic, or will they get another actor to sit within? Because I know Danny V was in R2 for the Skellig shoots, for the reshoots that they did. So I'm wondering whether maybe Danny V is going to step in.
Yeah, it seems like they will. I think they'll have a person do it as long as they can. Even with BB-8, did you see on the behind the scenes the guy pushing him?
Yes, yes.
I was like, how'd you get that job?
yeah, that's what I want to know. Because even when I was on set for episode 8, I saw those guys. Now they were working with a different creature. I'm not gonna say anything else. No spoilers. They were working with a different creature, but he was all dressed in his blue, you know, for the blue screen. It's insane. Like, it's how does one, what does one go to college to do that?
I don't know.
Look,
yeah, I think they need that human touch to add life to the droids.
Yeah.
Definitely.
I think so too. There is a life that needs to be brought that can only be brought from a human shaking it or whatnot. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely. All right. Well, should we move along to a few more news items?
I think we should move along. Not without saying anything less about Kenny. Kenny was a gentleman. I had the pleasure of meeting him, as I said, in the last episode. And, very sad to see him. And his influence and his effect that he's had on Star Wars and the Star Wars community is...
such an icon.
Iconic, you know, a giant of a man.
Yeah. Rest in peace, Kenny.
One with the Force now. The show must go on, Kate, though.
Yes. Okay, so just a few more, news bulletins that have happened in the last couple weeks, I guess. So the premiere date for Rebels Season 3 was announced.
Woohoo!
Which we've already seen.
Yeah, I was going to say, I was like, do we gloat here? Ha ha ha, we've seen it.
What was it, the first two episodes?
First two episodes we saw. First two episodes,
although,
yeah. Don't say anything. Yes, I will put my hand up. We did, we were on the tired side of the week. That was probably the most tired I'd been all weekend.
Yeah, we kind of fell asleep.
Yeah, it's terrible. It's like, it's the worst thing in the world.
Due to sheer exhaustion.
Yeah. You see, I can say that, so we, the context on the napping during Rebels is, we were up and in the XL Center, which is the convention center where Star Wars Celebration was held in London this year. We were up and there for 5:45 every morning. Okay. Now, when I left the convention center, I was there with 3 friends who weren't necessarily the biggest Star Wars fans. So I left and had a few alcoholic beverages with them that night. So every night, I was getting between 3 and 4 hours sleep.
Oh, man. Okay. I was getting more sleep than you then.
Yeah,
I was exhausted.
And then, okay, we get up and, you know, like, Rebels was one of the panels that I definitely wanted to be at. Like, that was, like, my panel, because I missed the Rogue One panel because we flew in too late. But Rebels was the panel that I wanted to be at. So, picture this, listener. We're sitting in a nice, dark, warm room. Nice and cozy with, 6,000 other Star Wars fans. The telly's on. Everybody's having a good time, and Kate and Jamie are absolutely shagged. We're just so tired.
I think Gary was thoroughly disappointed in us.
Yeah, no. To be honest with you, I mean, I'm not overly upset because I'll get to see it again.
Yeah.
What I was there for was more for the cast and the, you know, the what we're gonna learn about season. I mean, I saw the majority of it. I think I probably only KO'd for about 10 minutes, I'd say. I think.
I don't even know how much of it I was out for. But if it makes anyone feel better, when I got home, I had such bad jet lag for a week, but my friends wanted to go see the new Star Trek movie, and I totally fell asleep during it. It was really good, but... It's like when you get to that point where you're just like so exhausted, like
yeah,
you
yeah.
Help it.
I'm still yet to see that actually. I've heard I probably won't like it. I heard it's oh, really? I heard it's very Trekkie, which is probably where I need to check it.
I thought it was really good.
Yeah, it's kind of probably beyond me, I'd say. I liked the Abrams ones because they weren't very Trekkie. Mm. You know, they were more like blockbuster films, whereas I hear this one is quite Trekkie.
Yes.
Just not my thing, Kate.
That's okay.
Rebels Season 3 premiere.
Star Trek. Yes. Okay, so we didn't actually say when it was, did we?
That's what I was going to say, yeah. When is it?
September 24th, 2016. So,
September 24th.
That'll be here before we know it.
I wonder if that's the same in Ireland and the UK.
Oh, I don't know.
I'm going to check this now. Bear with me.
Okay. Shall I give a summary of the Star Trek movie while we wait?
Go for it. Go for it.
There
and it all
some
starts.
Interesting parallels between the girl Jayla and Rey.
Oh, really?
Well, kind of, because they both were like, stranded scavengers on a planet.
Okay.
And they both like had a staff and they both are awesome.
So I can now confirm, Kate Dubinko, that the UK air date for Star Wars Rebel is indeed the 24th of September 2016. And mm-hmm. for anybody interested, it will be airing on Disney XD, I would say in around probably 5 or 6 p.m.
Awesome.
That's just based on when the previous seasons from a time perspective, that's when they were the previous premieres were.
Cool. So do you think we'll do another round table for the premiere?
For the premiere, now that we will both have actually seen it. we may have to. We'll have to see what the story is.
There you go.
You know, people seem to like the round tables, which is great.
Sweet. Okay, so next up is a very curious story.
Very curious.
I noticed on Twitter last week that some people were talking about the making of the Star Wars The Force Awakens book being canceled.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess the author, J.W. Rinsler, he tweeted, I guess this was on August 4th, somebody asked him if the making of The Force Awakens is still coming out this year, because it's been, like, pushed back, I think a couple times already.
Mm-hmm.
So he's saying, Amazon notified me to say my pre-order was canceled and unavailable. Then J.W. Winsler responded, yes, am asked this often, but book was canceled. You'll have to ask Lucasfilm Disney / publisher why. So that's on August 4th that he said it was canceled.
Yeah.
I don't think we've had enough official statement from Lucasfilm or Disney or anything saying that, have we?
No, well, I haven't seen anything, but I don't know if, and I was kind of saying this to you before the show, I don't think they're going to cancel this. I mean, they have the making of books. I mean, I've got one for The Empire Strikes Back, and it's amazing. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely beautiful.
Yeah, and everybody like is dying to read this book.
Yeah.
Especially like with Harrison Ford and all that stuff that happened with him.
Exactly. You know, and maybe that's why it's been pushed back. Maybe there's stuff in there that Disney don't want coming out. And we know that there's still some legal issues around that whole thing.
Right, I was just going to say that.
So maybe there's just stuff in there that while legal proceedings are you know, underway, that they can't release this book.
It's silly because it's been written already and they have content there.
And I'm going to go out on a limb here and say Disney and Lucasfilm like making money?
I don't know.
Now, they haven't released an official statement to say this, but I'm pretty sure they do like making money. Especially Lucasfilm.
especially Disney too, man.
Yeah, no, when I say that, I mean like, you know, all the different... Here's the special edition. And
that's another thing I didn't even put on the list.
Are you talking about what I think you're going to talk about?
That there's already another edition of The Force Awakens coming
out? The fudge.
The 3D
people,
Blu-ray, right?
People are pissed about this.
That's so dumb. Like, I don't even know if I'm going to get it.
I won't get it.
Yeah.
Like, I don't understand it. I really, really don't understand it.
I know, that's kind of, like, really, really.
It's lame. It's lame.
Because there's new extras on it and JJ yeah. commentary and like.
And unfortunately, really... do you know what this is going to do? It's going to push people online to download it illegally.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I would have happily, what did I pay? I paid €17 for the Blu-ray of The Force Awakens in my local Disney store. And I pre-ordered it and I got like the exclusive cover and I got a couple of pop figures and stuff. I would happily have paid €30 for an extended edition or extended bonus features or, you know, to get all them and like the JJ commentary. I would happily have paid more for all of them at once. Whereas now what's going to happen is people are going to, who have the Blu-ray or who have the DVD already, are just going to go straight to the torrent market and just download it there. You know, crazy. I'm not saying that's what I'm gonna do because no. I actually happen to know someone who is mad about 3D films and will get this. So once he's finished watching it, I'm just that's gonna what grab
I,
it off
I was thinking along the same lines because I have a friend who's got a 3D TV and stuff. I was thinking I could possibly buy it for her
as a present and then take the extra special edition disc.
Yes.
yeah no, I think unfortunately that's a stupid move. Now I don't think there are stupid moves made by Disney, but I just don't understand it at this point. I do think it's going to push people to watch it in other means.
Yeah, definitely, you know? And if you just wait like 5-10 years, I bet there'll be like a extra special edition come out with all the features on it or something.
Do you know what I would buy?
What?
A director's cut.
Ooh, that'd be cool.
I the one thing I said, and I probably said it in our episode once we sat down to talk about The Force Awakens, I could easily have done another hour of story fill, you know? Like, I felt that The Force Awakens was great, and it was a huge, great return to Star Wars cinema. But I felt the pace was just so quick. It was just boom, 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 boom. You know, I think from the conception of the, you know, the moment we meet Starkiller Base to it being destroyed, I think we're talking like 25 minutes.
Yeah.
Do you know? So, I mean, I would buy another DVD of it if it was the director's cut.
There you go.
I'd say give it 6 months at this rate.
Right?
Yeah, yeah. So anyway, going back to it. So do you think this book is actually canceled?
I don't know. It just seems so weird.
Have you read...
Like, by the time it comes out, it'll probably be like after episode 8's already out.
Absolutely, yeah. Have you read the art of Star Wars The Force Awakens?
No, just kind of looked at some of the pictures. I haven't like actually read it.
So a lot of the content is actually in there. So they talk about, you know, how they... you know, came to be with what Kylo Ren looks like and how they designed what Jakku was going to look like. You know, so a lot of the actual, like, making of is actually, like, now it's the much more finer detail. It's the nitty-gritty bits of the making of, like, not so much the actual production end. But, I mean, if you were to piece that together with, you know, some of the Entertainment Weekly stories that came out around the time of production, like, you could nearly piece it all together yourself. So, I mean... the content is all there.
Except
so what...
maybe this Harrison Ford business.
Yeah. I think that's what probably what's going to hold. What's holding
they found
it up.
That guy. They found someone guilty, right?
Yeah, no, there is. There's an ongoing case about it at the moment in the UK.
Yeah.
I think it's a studio situation, actually.
Okay.
You know, so I'd say that I would put money on it that that's why it's been held up. And we will see this book just... not in October. That's my official ruling.
Our illustrious leader has spoken it.
yeah, it's marked in stone now.
There you go. Okay, so one last news point before we get on to some interviews and stuff and more Ireland talk. So episode 8 has begun editing. How do you feel about that?
Very excited. Very, very excited. I just, this is the part where we actually start to get things. Do you know what I mean? We're going to get, like, you know, shots from the set. We're going to get, you know, snippets from Rian Johnson. Like, Rian Johnson's already, that's how we know about it, is because of that post that he did on Instagram. Mm-hmm. I think this is where we start to get teased about what we're going to see in episode 8. I'm particularly excited to see what I saw just in an actual piece of footage, you know?
Yeah.
Those are the bits that I'm really excited about. But look,
cool.
If he's editing, that means we're getting the film.
And then also it was announced about John Williams working on the episode 8 score too.
What a man. What a man. You know, yeah. I think what they need to do is, you know, without being too morbid, and I know we're talking about death a lot in this episode, but they need to get him thinking about episode 9 pretty quickly, I think.
Oh man.
It's great, and I think some of the you know, the not the rush to get into edit, but obviously the editing is obviously to, in order to allow John Williams to start to compose his pieces, you know.
Cool.
That is exciting. It means that episode 8 is just that step closer to where it was.
When do you think we'll get our first teaser of episode 8 or title?
I'm going to say not before.
Do you think it'll be before Rogue One?
No. No, I don't think they're going to put anything episode 8 before Rogue One.
That would be awesome.
They've got such a colossal job to do with marketing Rogue One and allowing the lay cinema goer to understand what this film is about. That if they started putting anything episode 8 out related, I think it'd be a mistake. When is D23?
Oh, I don't know. Is that like every other year or something?
I think it's before Celebration though. In the year, I think it's like February or March.
Oh, I don't remember.
So I think it'll be next year before we get anything. I think it might be even
a title?
We're not gonna get a title, I don't think, before.
What?
I don't think so.
Did you get any hints while you were on set?
Nope. Everything that I saw just said Space Bear. Which is kind of cool at the same time, like, you know, all the call sheets and all, like, the safety.
What if that's the actual title?
Star Wars Space Bear. You know, I presume they'd be referring to Mark Hamill's Ewoks. New look.
Oh.
Yeah, the return of the Ewoks. Yeah. Awesome. Luke Skywalker actually brought a conservation of Ewoks to Atu.
Nice.
Look, episode 8 is that little bit closer, and that's what really excites me about this news.
Yes. Shall we move along to the next segment?
Sure, why not? Ms. Dubinko, this is your show.
Do you want to do the honors, or shall I?
Binko the Hutt? Is this
Punch
the...
Punch Chewy?
Yeah, I was going to say, is this Punch It Chewy?
Yeah, that's what I was talking about.
Punch It Chewy. You can have two.
Okay, so Ireland.
Woo-hoo.
Let's talk about Ireland.
Let's. I'm here. You know, we may as well talk about it.
So what's it like over in Ireland?
It's dark at the moment.
Oh, yeah, huh?
Yeah, it's been pretty crap weather recently, though.
Yeah, so last month I got to visit Ireland for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
It was pretty awesome.
Did you enjoy yourself?
Yeah, I enjoyed myself. It was so fun. Like, I just wish I could have spent longer. It just felt like it was so... Especially, like, in Dublin.
Yeah.
Because really, I only got to spend, like, 2 days there.
Yeah, well, that's...
I ended up in Portmagee the majority of my time in Ireland.
Which is not a bad place.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was awesome. But I just felt like there was so much to explore in Dublin, and I, barely scratched the surface.
It's okay. I don't think it'll be your final trip here either. I think we might have just scratched the surface on Kate Dubinko's Irish adventures.
There you go. I'll have to keep my eye out on cheap airfare again, man.
Yeah, definitely. Well, you know where we are. We're not going anywhere anytime soon anyway.
Awesome. But yeah, so it was really cool to visit Ireland. And especially my trip to Skellig Michael, to actually be right where they were filming Star Wars was amazing, and it felt like I was in the movie.
You've done stuff that I haven't done.
It helped having those people dressed up as Jedi, like that really added to the atmosphere.
yeah, absolutely. I'd say that made that Star Wars visualization a little bit easier.
Yeah, it was so cool. But yeah, that was like right by the rock where Luke was standing. That was so cool.
So come here, you've done Skellig, you've been to Attu. I know we're gonna hear from.
Is that how you say it?
Attu.
Yeah.
Well, that's the way I've been saying it.
Is that how they said it on the set?
Well, no, they didn't really mention it on set.
Nobody knows for sure, like, how it's pronounced.
Yeah, Attu is how I've been saying it. I just think A-C-H-T-U.
Attu.
No, Attu. Attu. Like, I've heard that it's, like, Attu. Attu.
Yeah, I don't know about that.
But I just, English is a funny thing, because what'll happen is that, you know, if you make a word too difficult to say, it'll just eventually change to whatever the most, you know, whatever the easiest way to say it is. So I think Attu is probably the, you know, for me anyway. But I've heard people, I think Gary is Akatu, you know, which is, Akatu is what Gary
sounds
calls
like
it.
Akatu.
yeah. But so you've actually been there, you've done it. I mean, when you saw The Force Awakens, okay, first and foremost, obviously we were doing this, you were great pals with an Irish guy. you know, it was this elusive world that you'd never been to. What was Ireland in your head before you got to Ireland?
Well, like, you always hear, like, the Emerald Isle. So I was picturing it pretty green, which it is.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that was pretty much... I mean, it is. It's so... You know that it's beautiful and green like that, but like, it is seriously gorgeous.
Especially down around Kerry. I mean, it's literally there's nowhere, like, better in the world when it's a nice day.
Which we'll get into. But like there's just like the scenic overlooks. Like when I was driving back to Dublin, like especially like when you're right along the coast, like there's so many scenic stops where you can just like stop and take pictures. It's just so pretty.
And what about the Irish lifestyle? So what were you expecting by way of like how we live? And then, because you saw some interesting things that I'm very happy you saw, like all the mad quirks that Irish people have.
Well, yeah, particularly when I was like in the rural setting, like with Portmagee, and like I think you're referring to one thing was the shepherd with all the sheep that just like overtook the road.
That happens awesome. So often. So it's like, it's a farmer and his sheep. And so we have these little, I presume you drove down one of them. They're called boreens. Okay. So a boreen is like a small, tiny little road. Okay.
Are those the one lane roads?
They're one lane. Yeah. And they're usually between two fields. And there's usually, there's usually a patch of grass just running down the middle where the cars don't drive on it. You know, it's the only place on the road that the grass will grow. So you know, usually what happens is a farmer is bringing his sheep from one field to the next field, and then usually what happens is he just takes up the whole road. And you know, it happens so often, you've no idea.
Awesome.
And it's like we just really don't care. It's just like, ah, sure, here we are, there's the lads. Awesome. You know,
it was funny because that was the day when in the morning my tour to land on Skellig had been canceled. So I just went for, I was like really like upset, obviously. So I just like went for a walk. And then I saw this sheep with the shepherd with all the sheep. And I was just like walking. Like I could have, like some of the sheep started like coming over towards me.
Yeah. You can't help but laugh at that point, can you?
That was pretty awesome.
So come here, actually, you've touched on a very interesting point there, which is also interesting to let other people know. Anybody who's looking to travel to Skellig needs to be aware that the boats are never 100% confirmed to go. Based on your experience, what would your
recommendation
advice be? Yeah, I mean, like, I think it's crazy.
Yeah, it's really, I mean, the landing on Skellig, since it's so rocky, I guess. I think that's why. It's a really treacherous landing on a good day. So if the weather's even that bad, they don't want to take the boats out and risk it.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess if you really want to land on Skellig, I would just recommend like blocking off like a week. Maybe,
okay.
Maybe not a whole week. Maybe like 3 or 4 days. But I don't know, like, if you, with some of the people that you can book with, if you could just ask, like, any of those days. I'm
yeah.
not sure how that works with them, but...
Well, it seems to be kind of like this odd, typically Irish setup, where it's like, you're booked in today, but yours didn't get to go today,
yeah.
so you went home. And you might have
yeah.
had tomorrow booked, but because you got to go today... You know, it's kind of this weird that
yeah.
like spaces seem to free up based on people either come and not able to go and
right.
leave.
Because I was able to go the next day then.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, I suppose for people who want to come and land, you would say give it a couple of days and just let
yeah.
the tour guides know that you absolutely 100% want to land. Because I think what you did right was you made it very, very... well known that look, I don't care how long I have to sit here, get me on a bloody boat and get me to the rock.
I think you might have had something to do with that too.
Yeah, I was on the phone to Patricia in the moorings, who is the best in the world, by the way. Thank you very
They're
much
awesome.
Patricia,
stay at the moorings too, that's my other
yeah
advice.
I rang up Patricia and I was like, look, situation is this girl is coming all the way from Arizona. I was like, there's one thing she wants to do in Ireland, and that's go to Skellig. I was like, it would be an absolute shame. It would be a crime if she didn't get out to Skellig. And to be fair, Patricia jumped through every single hoop
yeah.
that there was to be jumped through to get you out to Skellig.
They were awesome.
So if let's say, for whatever reason... Mick and Mary arrive in from New York and they want to go to, I don't know why I said Mick and Mary, the two most Irish names anyway, they arrive in and they want to go to Skellig, but it's actually forecasted to be a crappy week. Maybe not like
yeah.
too bad, but like you actually went out on a boat trip as well.
Yeah,
so
the day before.
Us,
and...
Yeah. Tell us a little bit about, obviously not about the result, but... tell us.
So that first day I went down for breakfast and they're like, oh no, it's canceled. And I was like, oh no. So then I went for the before mentioned walk.
Mm-hmm.
Then I went to visit, and you'll actually be hearing like some interviews and stuff later on. But then I went to the Skellig Visitor Center and
yep.
I talked to the guy that's in charge over there, John, right? Yeah.
Yep.
He was on our panel, our Blah Blah Lie panel, correct?
Yeah, he was awesome. He knows everything
yeah.
there
You'll
is to know.
You'll hear from some of those
about.
Guys again. But so I chatted with him and then he was like, you know, I think some of the boats are starting to go out. You should go back into town and check it out. So I was like, okay. And I like ran back and there was one of the cruises that just goes around the islands was like leaving like pretty much right away. So I was
mm-hmm.
like, okay, well, I mean, it's better than nothing. So I guess I'll do that.
Yeah.
So, but they had been canceled for a reason earlier that day. Because the waves were so rough and it was 3 hours at sea. Like it doesn't even stop or anything really.
Okay.
So, I made it about to the part where you start going around the islands and like, I got some really cool pictures of both Skellig Islands, the Bird Island and then Skellig Michael.
Mm-hmm.
He's called the Bird Island.
Yeah.
Cause it's overtaken by birds. And then I started feeling really, really sick.
Oh, no.
And so, like, I was, like, I put my head down, like, on my lap, and I was just trying to focus and, like, not actually get sick.
Yeah.
And so, yeah. And then, but it was, like, it was so rough. Like, I was sitting in a weird spot. I felt like I kept getting, like, thrown about.
Okay. So it was really, it must have been really rough.
It was pretty, I don't know, did you ever see the video I posted with the dolphins?
Mm-hmm.
So
yes.
You can kind of tell in that video just how rough it is, but it was so rough. And so I was basically just the rest of that boat ride sitting with my head on my lap, just trying not to get like actually sick.
Yeah, yeah.
And then the boat landed and I think I must have looked like awful.
Oh, really?
It's like, are you okay? And I was like, as soon as the boat stopped, I was fine. But yeah, and then I just, that night I just kind of went and like, I think you recommended to go down and have some soup.
Yeah, yeah, because you were so cold as well, actually, weren't you?
Yeah, because it was freezing too, and so.
That's again another, another real Irish remedy for an ailment. It's like, oh, if you've got a chill in your bones, down there, soup and a sandwich, you'd be sorted. Yeah. Right as rain. Soup and a sandwich and a cup of tea at the end of it.
There you go.
Fix any illness.
And so I went back down to the... Actually, I ended up... The only spots were in the pub area where Mark Hamill pulled his Guinness, of course.
Mm-hmm. In the moorings.
But that bar. Was the night where I met... What was that?
That was in the bridge bar, which is connected to the moorings, right?
Yes. Yes. So that was also the same night where I met Kylo Ren and his mother and the Jedi. And so they were... I think they were staying there, too. And then they were getting, like, photo ops by that thing where you can say, like, I pulled a pint where Mark Hamill did. And
yeah,
so then I ended up seeing all of them again the next day when I actually landed on Skellig Michael. So awesome. That was awesome.
And they were all going to Celebration as well.
They were all at Celebration, too. Yes.
It's like a perfect circle.
I did actually run into the Jedi woman at Celebration, so that was cool. And I'm following Kylo and his mother on Twitter now, so that's awesome.
Okay, cool.
But yeah.
So
of course... Oh, sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, so if just to kind of wrap up that first day,
mm-hmm.
if I got to Skellig, or if I got to Portmagee and it was too rough to land, there are still options.
Yeah. Right.
And the options are...
So of course you can go to the bridge bar, and of course you can see they have this whole little setup. I actually didn't do the pint challenge. I don't know why.
Nah.
Should have probably.
Okay, well, you were too busy being lady of the sea, you know.
And running everywhere to get interviews and stuff, so.
Yeah. And you got caught behind a lot of sheep.
What was that?
I said you got caught behind a load of sheep, so.
Oh, yeah. There you go.
Yeah.
But yeah, so if you're not able to go out to actually land, or if it's even too rough for the cruise tours. So yeah, you can just definitely check out the bridge bar, and you can go right over to Valencia Island where the visitor center is.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was really interesting because it really gets into the history of the monks who built all the steps and the monastery. And
yeah, which is very, very similar to what is happening right now in Star Wars, or what seems to be happening with Luke in Star Wars.
Yep. Exactly. Mm-hmm. And then they have like I can't remember how long it was, a short movie about the history of Skellig and the puffins. And oh yeah, I haven't even mentioned the puffins.
Well, I presume awesome. that'll come with your landing story.
Yes. But yeah. So, I mean, there's the visitor center. There's so much touristy stuff that you can easily spend some time if I mean, a lot of people were recommending me to go, what's the name of it? This little chocolate shop? But I think it was a little ways. You needed to have a car.
Okay,
to
yeah. get there. Yeah, but actually, that's another thing. It's not the easiest place to get to Portmagee.
Right.
So you actually opted in the end just to get a car and drive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was an adventure in itself.
Yeah. So would you say that's definitely the easiest and best way for people to do it? Like the most convenient?
I still think it was because, I mean, I looked into the public transportation options and there's a lot of different changes you have to make. And you still have to like rent a car or get a taxi the last stretch.
And even at that, the from the train station to the actual village of Portmagee, it's still probably about 20-25 minutes, like, you know,
right.
So it's a long stretch in a taxi.
Yeah, exactly.
And so I suppose
it's nice to just have your own car and to be able to go and do
exactly
whatever.
And I mean, like, where you were is not a million miles away from the episode 8 locations.
Yeah, you could go explore, I guess.
Yeah, but like, other than going into Dingle, for the episode 8. I mean, I've heard people who have gone in search of these locations, but I mean, there's nothing there anymore. See, there's nothing actually to see. Right. So they are actually very, very hard to find now.
Yeah.
So moving on. So you had your soup, your sandwich, and your cup of tea, and you're ready to take on. You got the good news then that Skellig was open for business the next day.
Yes. Yay! Well, it actually had went out later that same day, correct?
Yes, yes.
While I was on that boat.
I was trying to call you. I was like, get off the boat, swim back to shore.
Or just have them drop me on Skellig. I was feeling so sick by that point. I was almost like, can we just stop on the island?
Yeah, please? Yeah. I need to get sick. The next day you're getting ready and you're heading towards Skellig, mm-hmm. and you're gonna land.
Right. So the next day I woke up and right away they're like, yeah, yep, it's going out. And I was like, yes. And like, I just kind of walked out by the shore and I could tell it was so much calmer and it just was like going to be the most beautiful day ever. And so like the waves were so smooth, like I didn't even feel sick at all. So I was I wasn't too concerned either because I knew it wouldn't have been as long. It would have only been out to the island, and then it was that extended length with the super rough waves, which was
of course
issue.
So
of course we landed on Skellig and it was amazing. It's just like it looks like on the movie.
Yeah.
I know, like, we've mentioned before about how they didn't use any special effects or anything. It's that stark shale.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like that gray is the rock. And then you see, like, the contrast with the bright greens. And then the sky was just, like, so blue that day. And then there was just, like, the perfect white clouds. And all the puffins were everywhere.
Found a new love.
That'd be awesome. What was that?
You found a new love.
Puffins?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're so cute. Like, they were so friendly, too. Like, I think they would have let you pet them.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they weren't afraid of humans at all. And they were, like, posing for pictures.
That's insane. Yeah. Those are some well-trained puffins.
They're so cute.
So you've actually walked the Jedi Steps?
Yep.
What was it like? I mean, I know you're at the same time trying not to kill yourself. You know? I mean, it's very dangerous.
Well, yeah. It is.
So, I mean, do you have enough time?
I mean, they
time?
Give you a safety talk before you go up. And, like, it's crazy because, like, some of the steps are just, like, tiny, like, couple inches. But then, like, towards the top, like, some of the steps were so big, like, I was literally, like, climbing them.
Okay.
So you have to be really careful and, like, you probably shouldn't be periscoping.
when I was watching your periscope, I was like, please don't die. Please don't die. Please don't die. I was like, this
no,
would
I was
be
being careful.
This would be
but when
the
guy,
worst way
the,
to
when
start
I was
this.
Trying, when I was exiting the boat, I was trying to periscope that and the boat guy was like, no.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. And he's probably
like,
right.
Okay. Yeah. But no, I was being careful on the steps.
So,
but yeah.
Whilst you're trying not to die whilst climbing the Jedi steps, did it actually register? Like, did the kind of the awesomeness of the occasion register with you? Like, were you able to actually take in the fact that you were doing this this pilgrimage, I suppose?
Yeah, I mean, it was long enough where, like, especially, like, it was cool because I got to be there with those other Star Wars fans.
Mm-hmm.
And we, like, it was long enough. You have enough time where you can walk all the way up to the monastery, which actually was smaller than I thought it would be.
Okay.
Like, I think they said the maximum amount of monks that would be there is, like, 12. And I don't know. I was expecting it to be, like, way bigger than that. Huh. But, yeah, I went in some of the little beehive huts. I think I have a video of that somewhere. I was like, I could totally live in one of these.
Yeah, where do I sign up?
Right?
Yeah.
So that was cool. And yeah, I was just kind of having fun exploring all the little nooks and crannies in the monastery area.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, so there's enough time to go up and do that, and then still like walk down and, you know, the Christ's Saddle, I believe it's called.
Yeah.
Area where Luke was standing at the end of the movie. And so, yeah, there was enough time to really just, like, I actually just sat there for a while and just kind of soaked it all in. That's also when I took, like, my BB-8 picture and my lightsaber pictures and then,
yeah.
You know, like, the pictures with the other Star Wars fans. And so there was really enough time to really kind of just soak it in and
do everything that needed to be done. Yeah, amazing. And yeah. Come here. When you were on the island, did it seem that people were there mostly for Star Wars or for the religious aspect of it?
No, I wouldn't say the majority is Star Wars. I mean, it was, so there was like 1, 2, 3, there was like 5 of us for sure. I mean, and then you could see a few people wearing like Star Wars shirts and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I think some of them probably are religious in nature, but some of them are just like, they just want to do it because it's interesting.
Yeah.
But, like, I don't think at this point, like, Star Wars is the majority. I mean, it's definitely a good chunk of their tourism there.
Yeah.
But, I mean, and I don't think it should be either. I mean, it should be what its original roots were. I think that should stay an important part of its history. And
100%. And I know that I've said it before that one of my main questions for the lads at our celebration panel was, how do you balance, you know, the right. two very contrasting, you know, how do you not exploit the natural and original right. purpose of this island by bringing Hollywood too far into the marketing and whatnot?
Right.
You know, and they said that regardless of how many people come for Star Wars, the same amount or more will come for the religious and the curiosity of it all, do you know? So I right. don't think that they're too worried about that. It just happens that Star Wars fans are excited about this now. Do you know what I mean? Like right. this was on the radar for a lot of people for a long time. Yes.
Yeah. So
but you know, I think it's great, but I do think it will be. I think it will be a challenge for them to kind of split the marketing.
Right, I was almost wondering if it would be a good idea to do specialized like Star Wars tours.
Mm-hmm.
Because you know, like where the whole boat would just be like hardcore Star Wars fans, and then like they would have like a tour guide to special
who is Star Wars led.
You could definitely tell, like. There's like a division, like if you're there and you want to mm-hmm. see like where Luke stood, as opposed to if you want to see the origins of these monks, like
yeah. There's the Star Wars story to be told as well as.
Yeah, that might be something they could look into. It would be kind of cool.
Did they work the Star Wars element into the tour guide?
On Skellig Michael, you mean?
Yeah.
No, not really. If you wanted to know anything, you had to like ask them specifically. They didn't really say anything.
Okay, like, so they just bring you and chauffeur you around the island.
First, it's just the only tour guide. Like first, there's the safety talk. So obviously, there's no Star Wars there. And then they had like a couple of like they had some up by the monastery, and they would just tell you about the monastery.
Yeah.
And then if you wanted to know any questions like about the movie, like they kind of knew the stuff, like so you'd have to just like ask them.
Okay.
But it wasn't like part of their speeches or anything.
Perfect. So if you want to know, and do you reckon they would have the knowledge if you asked?
Yeah, I think they have like a general knowledge, like basically, yeah, like Christ Saddle, that's where Luke was. And
not quite the Mike O'Shea knowledge.
Yeah, that would be kind of cool to have like a super VIP behind the scenes.
Yeah. Our head of safety and logistics on the Star Wars shoot. So come here, it was amazing, I'm assuming.
Yeah. So while I was at Skellig, I had enough presence of mind to actually take my phone out and just do a little bit of recording while I was actually there. So I'm going to go ahead and play that for you guys right now.
Okay, it's July 12, 2016. I'm here at Skellig Michael. just finished, actually. I'm on the boat to head back. But I just wanted to record something really quick while I was actually here. Wow, it was amazing.
It was so incredible.
It's one of the most beautiful and amazing things I've ever seen in my life. And I mean, obviously, there's the Star Wars aspect to it, but just as a landscape, as a beautiful piece of this earth, it is incredible. And yeah, I'm just so happy I got to do that. I'll record more, obviously, probably later when I get back into Dublin, but now it's time to take off for another adventure. The ocean's a lot smoother today than yesterday, which I am grateful for. What else? Yeah, then it's back to Dublin. I get to go on another adventure, driving on the wrong side of the road again, so that'll be fun. Alright, that's it. Catch y'all later. Bye.
What I think is really interesting, just before we move into the, I suppose, the interviews that you've done, was that when we were at Celebration, this is just to give people who maybe didn't listen to the Celebration episode, go back and listen to the Celebration episode, a bit of context in that when we were talking to the guys from Portmagee, you know, they made reference to the fact that at Celebration, there was probably more people standing in the line for coffee, at Costa Coffee, as there was, as there are living in the entire village of Portmagee. It is a small place. So everybody that you met down there would have been somewhat affected and, you know, exposed to the circus that was The Force Awakens in Portmagee.
Yeah.
All right, so now we're going to move on to the interview portion of the show. First up, we're going to talk to Jared Kennedy. His wife is Patricia, who we mentioned earlier, and they own the Moorings. So they really got a close-up look at the inner workings of The Force Awakens and some of the cast and crew. So it was really interesting to talk to them. So I'll go ahead and play that one.
First of all, just how has Star Wars changed your way of life and here in Portmagee?
Yeah, well, I suppose it's changed gradually, you know. I suppose the real, it was really in 2014 when they came first to see the place and to see the Skelligs. I suppose that was the beginning of it, you know. And I remember they came in 2014 and it was like a few people came in and they said, look, we're doing a bit of filming on the Skelligs and we're looking for maybe to get some rooms and some food and things, and I said, oh yeah, that's okay, and we will do that. This was in January. Anyway,
so who was it that was talking to you at this point?
There was somebody from the Irish Film Board. Nisha Barry, I think, and Edmund. Edmund was here, and they went just to see this guy. I was to see the area, was there enough accommodation in the area for these people, you know? And they asked me and I said, yeah, we will. And they said, what are you doing? And they said, well, we're doing a documentary on puffins.
Oh, nice.
Very nice. So I said, that's fine, come back to me. And then somebody else phoned about 2 months later, a company that were trying to sort out the rooms for this film group. And they said, oh, we're looking for rooms for 100 and accommodations for about 150 or 180 people.
Wow. I have 18 rooms.
I said, that's some documentary, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, for puffins, right?
Yeah. So anyway, I was wondering. But anyway, it went on and on. And eventually they came and they decided they were coming and they were here. The room we're sitting in is now, they were here 6 weeks before the filming started. We still didn't know what filming was going on.
Wow.
They said it was going to be a fairly big movie, but they didn't say what it was about.
Wow.
So, but they asked me, we had sorted out the rooms, we had sorted out different
so
things.
So did you just let out all of them, all 18 rooms then?
Yeah, well, we had some of the rooms that were already booked by other people.
Oh, okay.
So we had to keep other people down on those bookings, and that was fine, you know. But there was a group of houses in the state of houses that they booked out, something like 12 houses.
Wow.
So, and then there was hotels in Waterford and in Valencia and different all around the area,
wow,
you know. So, but about 5 weeks, I think, before the filming, they asked us, could they take this room here, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So this room was a pre-production room.
Whoa, that's crazy.
So
we're sitting where the pre-production room in The Force Awakens was.
That's
crazy.
Yeah, this is so, it was so exciting for people who, you know,
so cool.
To hear that, yeah.
Yeah.
And anyway, this went on, and they were trying to organize food and in the mornings for going out, and they were trying to organize the boats, which they just, you can see out the window, the boats just leave there for skeletons.
Oh, okay.
And they were trying to organize that, and I was helping them do a lot of that.
Mm-hmm.
And then I suppose what happened then was about maybe a week, maybe before the story broke that it was Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
There was a bit of rumors about it, but I got a card from one of the people working, and they said, have a look at this card. And when I looked at the card, it was Lucasfilm's.
Oh, wow.
The card, and Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, oh,
wow.
My God, this is it.
Do you still have the card?
I don't.
Oh, no.
I don't think so, but maybe my wife might have it, actually.
Oh, that would be really cool
to
see.
So I really didn't know anything about Star Wars.
If you find it, I'll totally take a picture.
Yeah. Well, yes. I didn't get what Star Wars was about because I had no interest in Star Wars.
Oh, gotcha.
Whatsoever. But when I showed it to my wife, and my wife showed it to her brother, and he said, oh my God, he's a real Star Wars fan. He's the man that you'll meet next week now.
Oh,
he's
okay.
Crazy in it.
Yeah.
And he said, oh my God, this is fantastic.
Cool.
So the excitement started.
Nice.
And the village was, they arrived in with their buses and trucks and props.
Wow.
And film crews, and the place was just giant. And
wow.
The media were here.
Oh, I bet.
So, and we have some shot footage of all that.
Mm-hmm.
We did a bit of a documentary on it, you know.
Cool.
And so the village was very excited about it. And the village made a lot of money out of it, I suppose, as well, because
yeah.
The shops were being used and the people
oh,
were
I'm
working
sure.
on set. And, you know, so you had all those things. And I suppose then, like, the big night was the wrap night when they finished up, you
uh-huh.
know, that Mark Hamill and... his wife and his family were in the bar, and
wow.
you Daisy Ridley were in the bar. You saw the bar down
yeah.
there, and there was about 120 of them, and
wow.
it was their finishing night.
Nice.
So we put on a bit of traditional Irish music. My kids were dancing.
Is that like what we just heard down
yes,
there? Yes. Oh
that
wow.
Music, yeah. That kind of music, and then my kids were dancing and singing. You know, they're young. They're 11 and
nice.
And 9. You know. And he, Mark Hamill, was there, and he was just enjoying it, and I really didn't know the man, believe it or not.
Wow.
So until I saw him inside the bar filling a pint.
Wow.
And of course everybody, it broke loose, everybody
yeah.
said, oh my God,
that went viral. Like,
that went viral
yeah.
It did. And he went talking to everybody in the bar.
That's so cool.
So, and I think the good thing, it was, they were very comfortable. There was no security, there was no nothing.
Wow.
I think the local people were very very comfortable with
so
with
cool.
the whole crew, and the whole crew were very nice, you know, so
yeah,
it was great. But it was a great experience for us.
Yeah.
And I suppose now we can, at the time we really went through it, we were working, it was an August weekend when they were here, we really didn't take much notice about it, you know, because, you know, when we weren't into Star Wars and you
mm-hmm.
didn't really know how big it was going to be, but it is big.
Yeah.
And now people are bookings are way up.
Wow,
so,
I bet.
Yeah, so we put on a package, you know.
Oh, cool.
Pull a pint where Mark Hamill had his drink. We have rooms.
So how did Mark do when he pulled the pint?
He did very well. The video,
yeah.
I must show you the video. He did
yes.
very well in it. Actually, it's in the bar showing at the moment.
Oh, nice.
The video.
That's
so we
cool.
can see it there.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
Yeah.
What's the trick to pulling a good pint?
The trick is, well, the trick is the holding of the glass.
Oh, okay.
That's where it is. And you'll see that.
I
now.
Actually only had my first Guinness yesterday.
Is that right?
Yeah. Because I'm not much of a beer drinker,
yeah.
but my friends were like, you're in Dublin, you have to.
Yeah, yeah. Once you're in the country, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, it was pretty good.
Good.
Yeah.
But what else right happened, really? I suppose the big thing about it is that there was a bit of fear then, you know, when we heard how big it was. That,
yeah.
My God, would this destroy our little village?
Right.
You know. And it's amazing, I had a group of Americans,
mm-hmm.
they were English and Americans, they were a mixed group, I think there was about 20 or 15 or 20 of them staying with us for two or three nights, because
wow.
we do this package,
mm-hmm.
stay overnight, get a boat trip to the Skelligs and hear the story of Star Wars.
Nice.
And watch the video.
That's
and, you know,
so cool.
And pull the bind.
Yes.
And that's going very well. But we had a group here doing that, and they were real Star Wars fans, you know. And I said, oh, my God, this is great, you know. And they went out and they went to see this, the Skelligs, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And it was amazing when they came back in. Like, they were talking about the monastery there and the beehive huts and
mm-hmm.
the, you know, the whole energy
yeah.
of the Skelligs. It ties in with the Force, you know.
Right.
It really
yeah,
ties in with Star Wars.
That's
like,
really interesting,
you know?
Isn't it?
Yeah. And if ever you get a chance, I would, you should go.
Well, I'm hoping to go tomorrow if
yeah,
the weather's
if
okay.
The weather is fine, hopefully.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
So, did you see The Force Awakens? Did you go to the premiere or anything
I did.
Like that?
We were at the premiere, yeah.
Okay.
And yeah, it was a great night. Great.
Very
I mean,
cool.
It was very exciting.
So
even last night here.
Oh, I heard about that.
Did you hear about
it? I missed it by one night. I was so sad.
Yeah, they were showing it here outdoors.
And the weather was actually decent, I heard.
It was great. Now everybody was sitting out with their hot whiskies and their blankets.
So there was a good turnout for that?
Great turnout. Yeah, we had
awesome.
Great turnout, which was fantastic for the night, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, we went to the premiere and, you know, we find that bookings are coming in very, very fast.
Wow.
For this year and for next
year.
Oh,
I'm sure.
Yeah.
It probably books up like really far in advance too,
it does.
Huh?
Yeah, you need to get your bookings in there. Like, I mean, it's like these months are totally booked out. Maybe you might get one.
If
or
I
two
didn't
months.
Have special connections, I don't think I would have gotten in.
No, it is very hard. And all the B&Bs in the area
yeah.
are the same, you know.
Wow.
And the other thing is the boats, you see, the boats only take out so many people.
Right,
so,
exactly.
You know.
So when you saw that final scene in The Force Awakens where she's heading to the island, how did that make you feel? Just you live here and you see it all the time. So how did it make you feel to see it in such a big movie like Star Wars?
It was, well, as I said, you know, in the beginning, I really didn't have too much interest in Star Wars. And I said, you know, I'm going to sit through this. And my family had real interest in it, like, you know. But it was so emotional.
Wow.
And the amount of people, like when you, I mean, I was imagining how it would be.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, yeah, this is great. Because you see loads of films and documentaries. With
right.
Skeleton. But this was so amazing when they were sweeping in.
Yeah.
And do you know what I was afraid of, Kate, was that I mightn't recognize the Skelligs.
Mm-hmm.
But it was just as it is.
Yeah.
Which is...
Yeah, I heard the only like thing that they did was add more islands.
Just on
yep.
the distance, some vague
yep.
islands, yeah. And that, I thought it was very
amazing.
Emotional.
So beautiful.
And everybody stood up and started clapping and
wow.
clapping. Even last
So
night,
were you in Dublin then
I was
for
in
the
Dublin,
premiere?
Yeah.
So I think Jamie was there. You might have seen him.
Oh, he was there, so yeah.
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 But yeah, I can't imagine. That must have been so great for all of you Irish people to see that. Oh.
And we came to Killarney then the next day and watched it again.
Nice.
And then we watched it again last night.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's amazing.
So it is. It's very exciting for us. It's very exciting for
yeah,
this area.
Yeah, that's so cool.
And the people that are coming, the people that come about it, like, they just are so interested in hearing our story.
Yeah.
Our story is very simple, but they're meant to hear it, you know.
Yeah, that's really awesome.
Yeah.
So, like this, within the last couple of months, there's been a lot of filming in other locations in Ireland. Have you had like overflow from that at all? People just
yes.
wanting to like catch all those locations.
Yes, and I think that's going to be very important
mm-hmm.
that people are going to do all the locations. You know,
yeah,
they've done it in Dingle and they've done it in Malinhead, and yeah, and you do get an overspill. You get people wanting to see. You know,
right,
and it's great. I mean, here. If you don't get out until you can see it from the mainland and you can hear the story and you can go to the Skelligs experience and
cool.
all that, you know.
Very awesome.
Yeah.
Cool. So, do you want to tell people, like, how they can, like, if they want to stay here?
Right.
Like, how far in advance should they book?
Really far, I suppose. They'd want to be booking, like, if you, say, for the next season.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this season is nearly gone, you
right.
know. And the bookings are very high for the season. I suppose they could still book for maybe into September, which would be there. But the best thing they can do is get on our website.
Mm-hmm.
And I have it out there on the brochure.
Okay.
And you have to get on our website and book through the website. You can book a package. There's
cool.
a package with overnight accommodation, food. Like this, me talking to you and tell you the story about the Skelligs.
Yeah.
I'll tell you a story about the Star Wars if you want to hear it. We can book a boat trip for you. To go
mm-hmm.
land on it or to go around the Skelligs. And then we have a little map of the area where you can go and look. if you don't get out there, you can look at each point where you can see the skeleton.
Oh, nice. That's cool.
So,
very nice. Very awesome. So
and then you have the Irish music, of course, and you have, you
very,
know.
The authentic Irish experience,
yes.
Right?
Yeah.
That's cool. So this is like the westernmost
it is.
Point, right?
It is, yeah.
Very
western,
cool.
Most western point of Europe. It's where the first transatlantic cable went from Europe to Newfoundland.
Oh, wow.
Where the first connection.
Yeah. Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah, so.
So, is this the time of year where you see the puffins, too?
The puffins, no. Well, they'll be leaving now fairly shortly.
Oh, okay.
So, but there was, like May was, the end of May was, there was thousands of them there. It was fantastic.
Cool.
Yeah.
Did you guys get any mentions on the credits or anything like that?
We didn't, no. We no. didn't get any mention on the credits.
Aww.
No. No. We got mentioned everywhere else, though.
Yeah.
In the media.
I know, you probably were, like, international media all over the
we
place.
We were for a while, yes.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Cool. Well, we're going to be seeing you at Star Wars Celebration.
Yes.
So that's going to be awesome. Do you have any other, like, Star Wars related plans in the future?
Well, I suppose we have to see what the next... I know that the next movie coming out is big.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be big again, you know.
Yep.
So we'll kind of have to see what goes on there and we'll,
mm-hmm.
you know, we'll do something again, you know. But it is a very small little village
mm-hmm.
and you can only do so much. You can only...
Right.
You know, keep so many people, you know. So as I was saying, yeah, for the next season, really, you would want to be booking like in November, December.
Gotcha.
For...
Cool.
For the next May, June, July,
mm-hmm.
August. The boats don't go to the Skellig's until the 15th of May.
Okay.
So that's the start of it. But the boats go around from whenever the weather is fine. They can go in March.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you want to be booking for March or April, you need to be booking in November, December, really, like.
Good to know.
To be sure.
Right.
You know.
Just to get that reservation.
Yeah.
Cool. So, with Skellig Michael and... So I think the planet that it's on Star Wars is called Apt 2 or Atch 2. We're not really sure how it's pronounced yet.
Right.
But it's definitely like an integral part of the Star Wars galaxy. It's like where the first Jedi temple was and that kind of thing. Do you think that they'll actually go back to Skellig Michael at all to film?
I don't know. I mean, they went twice.
Mm-hmm.
And... I suppose they could go again in the future, you know. Maybe they might. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't think there's anything stopping them of going, you know.
Right.
Now, at the time, there was a bit of controversy about they doing some damage in the rock.
Mm.
And that's sounding rubbish.
Yeah, because there's probably so many, like, tourists and stuff anyways.
The wind and rain
right.
and gales of wind.
That's true.
So many storms out there,
that's
you
cool.
know.
So... How many times have you been, like, up and down on Skellig Michael?
Oh, I've been out loads of times fishing around it and landing in it. And
how many steps are there, like, to the top?
There's 365, is it, or something
oh,
like
wow.
that.
Oh,
yeah.
wow. That's
but
crazy.
It's a real, real... It's a very special,
mm-hmm.
special place.
Do you want to, like, give us a little background about the actual history
well,
of it?
Well, I suppose the best place for you to go now would be... I suppose there's see across the way. Do you see where the building is there with the grass on the roof? Do you see that?
Like way across there.
Yeah, just near the water.
Yeah.
That is the Skellig's. That's a visitor center
oh,
on the
really?
Skellig's, and I think it would.
How
be,
do you get across?
You
just
go across the bridge there.
Oh, there's a bridge.
Yeah. See, look
oh.
over here and let's show you.
Yeah, that would be awesome. I'll have to do that.
And that will give you. You have all the dates. You have everything. See that bridge.
Yeah.
And just walk across the
oh, okay.
And if you don't get out there, it will be a great place to go.
Yeah, please. Definitely. All right. Well, thanks for all the awesome information, Jared. It was really lovely talking to you.
Thank
so,
you.
Once again, what's your website that people can go to?
They can go to www.moorings.ie.
There you go. Very cool. All right. So, thanks again for talking to Blabba.
Thank you, Kate, and very nice talking to you.
Okay. So, next up, we're going to hear from two people that we've actually already heard from on Blabba before. So we're going to hear from Vincent and John, who we heard from on the Blabba Live episode at Star Wars Celebration. But they were just so awesome, and so it's just going to be a little more in-depth conversation with them. So Vincent is Jared's brother-in-law, so Patricia's brother. And John is the manager over at the Skellig Visitor Center. So I think I'll just go ahead and play these two interviews and then we can finish off the show.
Okay, so now I'm sitting here with local Vincent O'Keefe. How's it going?
Good, thank you.
Cool. So what was it like? You grew up here, right?
Yeah.
What was it like having the Skelligs in your backyard growing up?
That's a really big question. I guess the Skelligs is formed such a big part of the identity of Portmagee, which is the village we're from. And just to maybe contextualize this for your readers or listeners, pardon me, is you can see like you're sitting in the middle of it here. You can almost stretch your hands out in one direction and touch both ends of, you know, and one and the other and touch both ends of it. It's a tiny, tiny fishing village. It's got about 150 people in the village. And its primary sort of identity really has been linked to the Skelligs by virtue of the fact that it's the departure point for the majority of the boats who go to the Skelligs. So when I grew up here in the Bridge Bar, which is sort of the main bar in the village, which is also attached to the Moorings restaurant, which is also the main restaurant in the village. And when I grew up listening to, in the summertime, like the only topic of conversation or the first topic of conversation at the dinner table would have been who went out on the boats, how many people went out, as I said, that was kind of the lifeblood of the village, because we're in a really remote part of Ireland, so there's like next to no industry here. There's really only two ways you can survive, one or two to three, you know, primarily agriculture. The other would have been then potentially fishing and then tourism-related activity. Mm-hmm. So Skellig was the main tourist draw for the region.
Yeah.
Because we were, again, slightly off the beaten path in terms of tourism. So tourists would have done the Ring of Kerry, which is near us, but they wouldn't have come out to see us except to see the Skelligs.
Right.
So the Skelligs is just kind of just loomed over everything in this village. And when I was young, I moved from the village, from in the village to across the channel here onto the island of Valentia, where I'm overlooking the village, like literally just over the water. And but I can also see up and see the Skelligs. And it's just, how would I put it? I mean, it's this preposterous pyramid of sandstone that's sitting on the horizon, and it's just, you look out, that's and crazy. You're...
So you can just see it, like, from your windows?
Just from my windows, yeah. So it's like, it's just part of my view of the world, if you want to put it, you know, since I was, you know, a very little kid.
That's cool.
And, you look out at the place, and you're like, your first question really is what is... What in the hell is that thing doing out there, just sitting there, being all mysterious? So then I visited Skellig when I was like 7, and I got to see it up close.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and...
What were your thoughts when you were a kid then?
My thoughts as a kid is this place is really, really cool. You know what I mean? It's you could run up the steps, and you could see these incredible old buildings, and you could climb around them and all the rest of it, and... And it was just this pretty amazing, just amazing place to go. And I went there again like a whole bunch of times when I was a teen and so on and so forth. And then as I've grown older, I've gotten to recognize again just how special the place is. And so I've been there close on 50 times now at this point. Wow. So it's a big draw. And every time I come home, I try and get out.
That's cool. So obviously... I'm part of a Star Wars podcast, so I'm here on Star Wars related things. So, first of all, what was it like when the casting crew started coming over here?
I might just kind of give you a preamble to that, which was that I found out about this like well before the cast and crew came over.
Right.
The first sort of emissaries of the production was the pre-production crew who came to...
In the little city room.
Yeah, who basically came over to try and sort out the logistics of the production. So they were trying to sort out, okay, we need to get equipment to the island, we need to get, you know, facilities set up there. We need to get accommodation for everybody. We need to get health and safety sorted and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. So there was a kind of an advanced team from the production who came to sort all of those issues out, and they needed a place to do that. And they're in the middle of, they're in like the tip of the most remote mm-hmm. part of Ireland, mm-hmm. which is very little infrastructure and next to no business facilities. There wasn't like a business park they could go to and like do all this. So my brother-in-law George and my sister Patricia kind of were the kind of go-to people to help them figure out, okay, where do we even start with this?
Like, did they helicopter a lot of the stuff in?
What they would have done was they would have brought a lot of the stuff by trucks originally. Mm. Now, in the normal run of events, what you would do is you would helicopter the equipment from the mainland out to the island, mm-hmm. out to the island, because there is a helicopter landing pad out there, and you can do that. But part of the agreement with the production, between the production and the people who are in charge of Skellig Michael, mm-hmm. The authorities who kind of protected and preserved it and all the rest of it, called the OPW, was that the number of helicopter trips would be restricted to the bare minimum mm-hmm. To prevent any potential ecological impact on birds and so on. So the helicopter trips were actually restricted to largely getting the cast out there, so getting mm-hmm. Mark and Daisy out there, along with maybe JJ and, say, Kathleen Kennedy.
Cool.
So the stuff went out primarily on the boats. So there was a whole flotilla that took anything that was needed to get out there back and forth. So the boats, the local boats that ferry visitors to the island, were essentially not commandeered, but were requisitioned to transport all of the material that was out there. Mm-hmm. There was actually two bases. There was a pre-production base that was set up a couple of weeks beforehand mm-hmm. in the sitting room upstairs, which was actually, as I think I told you earlier, was my old sitting room as a kid.
Wow.
So it was quite a surreal insane. Experience to get a call saying that they're making Star Wars in the place where you get your Christmas used to get your Christmas wow. presents. That was the kind of the first advance party. And then there was, on the island of Valentia, there was a farm that was used as the actual unit base for, say, the catering, the video village, and wow. hair and makeup and costume and so on and so forth. So, and that was, but that would have been for the actual week that filming was going on.
Hmm.
So it was kind of a two-legged thing. And then the actual filming took place, obviously, then out on the Skellig itself. Right. So when, by the time the cast and crew came, which was about 3 weeks later, I had been kind of immersed in all of the excitement and also all of the dying to tell people about it, but we couldn't tell people about it. The story broke in a local paper, and then finally, at least, you know, I could acknowledge that something was going on.
Not just a puffin documentary
like people were being told. But that was, again, that was only, you could really only say it to kind of friends and family. You were still like massively aware that nothing could be said to any of the media. So there was this whole media frenzy that then, like, where lots of people from, you know, the national broadcaster came mm-hmm. and BBC and various other different people came to try and find the story, and nobody talked to them, frankly, because it was, you know, people just weren't inclined to talk about it and you know, so it was, when they showed up, I mean, it was obviously, it was, for somebody who grew up having seen Star Wars movies, mm-hmm. it was incredibly exciting, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it was also extremely difficult to keep that excitement bottled up and suppressed, you know what I mean?
So how was that different then with when they came back to film for Episode 8?
So with Episode 8, it was significantly easier, because with Episode 7, even when the story got out that the Star Wars was filming, there was no official acknowledgement of that by Lucasfilm or Disney. So essentially, the production that was done over 3 days in July, and they kind of came and left without really acknowledging that they were who they were, even though we all knew who they were. But with episode 8, because there had, by that stage, then there had been a formal acknowledgement that that filming had taken place on Skellig Michael, and that filming was coming back to Skellig Michael, you know, in a kind of a formal capacity, it was a little bit easier. And it was also made easier by the fact that whereas episode 7 was filmed right at the height of the tourism season, like on our literally our busiest weekend of the year, and the August bank holiday weekend, episode 8 was filmed in sort of the middle to late September. And so it was much quieter. There wasn't really that many tourists around. And so the actual production people kind of just hang out, and there's no problem. And we had, for example, we had Ryan Johnson and a lot of the production crew came in September for like a technical recce. So it was, they were just around the village and hanging out and all the rest of it, and came here to the, to the restaurant we're like sitting right in right where we're sitting, and had dinner and caught up and everything, and discussed all the stuff. So
that's around the same time when Mark pulled the pints, right?
That actually came about 2 to 3 weeks later. Later. Okay. So the technical recce is where they basically come and they kind of scope out, okay, let's get a feel for what we're dealing with here, with the kind of the main principal people involved. And then the actual production then rolled into town 2 weeks later with the whole shooting plan and the whole thing. So so they filmed for about, they had filmed for about 3 days, sort of in at the end of September, and there had been a, we had hosted the wrap party for episode 7 back the previous year, and then the guys came along this year, and what was interesting was that because episode 7 was so under wraps and so secret, the party was held largely for the people sort of involved in the production who weren't known. We couldn't have any actual cast members involved. Spoilers. Because it would have spoiled exactly the movie. Whereas by the time episode 8 came around, people knew that, you know, it was common knowledge that Daisy Ridley and Mark Hamill had filmed a scene in on Skellig Michael. So the fact that they might show up again wasn't going to spoil anything for anyone. So now, I didn't know that at the time, so I arrived late to the party, walked in and was sitting down just sort of ordering a drink, and then I looked around and I saw Mark Hamill talking to my twin brother, and I was like, that's interesting, I didn't expect to see him. And then I kind of picked up my drink and turned sideways, and I looked, and I was like, well, actually first I saw, then I looked across the bar from me and there was Ryan Johnson hanging out. Who was a lovely guy, by the way, because I met him actually on the day of production, and is total, I don't want to say a mensch. He was just such a nice, nice dude, like really, really, really humble, really, really respectful. And I'm really expecting that this is going to be a really, really great movie from him. But then I looked up to my left, and there was Daisy Ridley just hanging out and bopping along to the music. And it was it was really surreal, because I was just so, I had been up quite early that day, and I was just really, really tired. And I was all kind of like, is this actually real? Because this is where I grew up, and this is the entire sort of, the entire principal sort of people involved in Star Wars are sitting around and drinking and having fun and, you know, enjoying the music. So yeah, it was really special.
Yeah. So how has Star Wars affected Portmagee, like, now, presently?
At present, it's we're still in the process of figuring that out, because Portmagee would have been a place that, like, when I grew up and I said, hey, I'm from, people would ask me, where are you from? And I'd say Portmagee, and they go, where is that? And I'd have to explain, it's near, like, a town 50 miles away because that would be the only one they would recognize. Mm-hmm. But over the last few years, we've kind of become a little bit more well-known for various other reasons. And then this thing happened. And then suddenly the world, like the media is reporting about Luke Skywalker being in this tiny fishing village called Portmagee. And then suddenly people in, I don't have to explain where I'm from anymore, you know what I mean? So we're still figuring it out. There's definitely been a big uptick in interest in terms of going to the island, going to Skellig's. We can, like, Skellig was, I think I was one of the first people to actually publish information on Skellig's on the internet about 20 years ago. And I've been, like, fully aware of how kind of much interest has been in that topic over the years. And Skellig has been essentially like an internet sleeper hit in terms of tourism, because really on places like TripAdvisor, when people would be saying, oh, hey, where I'm going to Ireland, where should I go? Mm-hmm. Most people would say sort of standard Irish places like, oh, you got to go to the Guinness Storehouse and the Cliffs of Moher and all these types of things. And then there would be this voice that would say, you got to go to Skellig Michael. Yeah. It's amazing. It's incredible. And that sort of, there was a sort of a slight snowball effect from over the last sort of 10 years of that becoming more and more of a thing, where people were like, anybody who had been to Skellig Michael said, you got to go. And so that has had an impact on the number of bookings. People are obviously trying to get a little bit, or trying to get here in greater numbers than they had been. But then Star Wars happened, and that's just kicked it into a whole other, a whole other level. And whereas before there was like a chance that if you showed up on the day, maybe you could get a boat because there would be a place. Now it's, you pretty much have to book like weeks in advance to have any shot, really. So that's probably the biggest, that's the biggest impact it's had. In terms of the impact on us as a community, you know, we're just trying to figure it out. I don't know. I mean, people are interested in it, but the hilarious thing about the actual filming at the time is that we all grew up so far away from the cinema, and we grew up with like one channel on the TV that when Star Wars showed up, it was kind of like, oh, that's interesting. I've never seen it myself, but you know, that was most people's reaction. They were kind of aware this was a thing that was famous, but had no real, you know, they had never really seen it or whatever. So everybody was like just really, really cool and relaxed about it.
Yeah.
And so we kind of retain, I think we'll retain a lot of that. I think that people are like, yeah, Star Wars, it's a big thing and there seems to be a lot of interest in it.
Yeah.
But we're going to retain the essence of who we are, which is a small fishing community that, you know, is we just happen to be in a really, really pretty part of the world, and we enjoy people coming to visit us, and that's really kind of who we are.
Cool.
Yeah.
Awesome. So something interesting we were chatting about before was the parallels between The Force Awakens and So the Planet Actu or Achu, however it's pronounced.
However it's pronounced, I still don't know.
Nobody knows yet. I don't think we'll know until episode 8. But like, it's really interesting the parallels between that and the actual Skelligs. So do you want to tell us a little bit about that?
Okay, well, for anybody who does, well, most people who will be listening to this won't know the history of the Skelligs, but the Skelligs itself is this giant sort of improbably placed pyramid of sand, again, of sandstone sitting out in on the horizon from our coastline. So if you stand on anywhere on our coastline, you can see this thing just sort of standing, sitting there in the distance, and it's just, it's kind of like it was just dropped there like absentmindedly, that somebody, it was meant to be somewhere else, but just it kind of got dropped. So some, obviously when you look out at it, you're kind of like, what is that thing? And I got to get a closer look. And obviously you're not the first person to do that, because the people in back in around the 6th or 7th century had the same idea. They wanted to look at this place and find out what it was about, and it was known, probably known back again to antiquity, that this was a kind of a navigational point, as if you were a sailor. But in and around the 7th century, Christian monks who were looking to basically replicate hermetic tradition that would have been in the Middle East of monks going off into the desert or to live in caves or to contemplate God. They wanted to replicate that experience here in Ireland, and they looked out and saw this rock and thought, well, it's not the desert, but it's pretty isolated, and if I go there, I know that nobody's going to be bothering me. So basically a monastic settlement was set up on the island, started around this, again, the start of the 7th century, around 612, maybe something like that, 632 maybe. And that was populated by about, say, a dozen monks between the years, sort of, again, that time, the 600s, up to about the 1200s, 1300s. And so it was a place, basically, of monastic seclusion, of contemplation, of meditation, and people who were really, really serious about their Christian pursuit, you know what I mean? Wow. Their pursuit of the understanding of God. And so there's a theory that the places that places are imbued with the spirits of the people who have been there, you know what I mean? That something remains of those people. You definitely get a sense when you're on the Skellig that there's something very very unusual, very, very profound that's out there. It's a feeling that's really, really different from anything you would feel anywhere else. I've never felt it anywhere else.
Wow.
So there's the idea that Luke Skywalker would go, that if, what's really interesting for me is that, and maybe it's something that that would be nice for people who are coming to visit the island, is to come to visit it, not just because Luke Skywalker was here, but to come and see, well, if I was Luke Skywalker, why would I come here? Mm-hmm. And to see why somebody like Luke Skywalker would come here, to try and, you know, get his mind right, or try mm-hmm. and understand the Force or whatever, because there is a real resonance between what he is trying to do in the story, it seems, mm-hmm. and what people actually did in reality, and the feeling that you get in the island when you actually go wow. there. So, like, the guys couldn't have picked a better place for that. It's a weird kind of coincidence that, mm-hmm. that it's not just physically, like, a perfect place to represent this, but that the actual history of the island
yeah.
does feed into that.
Fascinating.
Yeah, yeah, it's really, really something.
Interesting. So then all the little huts, is that like where Luke Skywalker is going to live, do you think?
Well, I would guess so, because you need somewhere to you need somewhere to hide out from those Atlantic storms that are
right.
quite serious. That's where, certainly where the monks actually lived was
yeah.
They built these I don't know whether you can provide pictures for this on for your listeners, but they're essentially, yeah, like little circular huts made of stone, which were just literally just stone piled on stone. And they were found to be they were so solid and stable against these massive, massive, like,
yeah.
Weather conditions that they have persisted since the 600s, the 650s, you know, and against the worst weather that the North Atlantic could
mm-hmm.
actually throw at it.
Wow.
So they did, like, it was, they were these guys were smart when they put this thing together.
Wow.
So yeah, I'm sure they would be a little bit drafty, I'm sure, but I think that that if Luke was going to live there, you know, he going to live anywhere, you know, a beehive hut would be a good place to hide out.
Cool. So one last question: what do you think the future is for Skellig and Portmagee?
That's a big question. That's kind of like episode 8. I think we're just gonna have to wait and see. You know, it. I certainly hope that people, certainly people who are interested in Star Wars and people who want to come visit it, do come to visit it, and I hope as well that they can appreciate it not just for its role within Star Wars, but as a really as a treasure of our of not just this area, not just like Kerry or Ireland, but of what you know, what we as a species can do, you know, the amazing lengths that we'll go to search for meaning in our lives, you know. Mm. What I mean, so it's a really special place, and I would thoroughly recommend anybody who wants to visit somewhere extraordinary to come and visit us.
Awesome. All right, well, thanks for talking to Blabba, and may the Force be with you.
Thank you very much.
You I'm here with John O'Sullivan. We're here at the Skellig what is the name of this place?
Skellig Experience Visitor Center.
Skellig Experience Visitor Center. That's cool. So tell me about the building first. Is there any significance? It has like a grass roof and throx. Do you want to tell us about that?
It has significance in that it was built in 1992. This was originally just a field, an agricultural field, and from a distance they were conscious that the builders and the developers, that they didn't want to spoil the landscape. There was a bit of controversy about another visitor centre in another part of Ireland that was going to jut up out of the countryside. So they wanted to, first of all, the grass roof to blend in with the surrounding fields, and from a distance you wouldn't even maybe right. notice the building. In fact, they took a photograph of the fields before they started, and they took a photograph again from a distance when the building was finished, and you would hardly, it was like spot the difference.
Wow.
You couldn't tell anything in the two photographs.
Yeah.
And then the stone was, a lot of it was taken from a local slate quarry here in Valencia that possibly the monks would have taken out to Skellig to build their own. So the grey stone appearance, it's meant to be robust and strong, like the buildings that have lasted 1500 years out on the Skellig. So
That's cool.
Was a significant decision to use that type
really
of
neat.
Finish.
Cool. So do you want to just give us like a brief history of the Skelligs?
Well, the Skellig Experience Visitor Centre, as I said, was 1992. The Skelligs were there forever, maybe before that. But this was designed to kind of bring the story from 8 miles out onto a mainland visitor centre where tourists who wouldn't always necessarily be able to get on a boat and get out to Skellig's could,
like me,
like a lot of people, like me.
Yeah,
you need a good head for heights going up there. You know, it's a lot of steps up. There's no
handrail, right.
No aid. You need a good head for heights coming down. So not everyone will do that, and then you've elderly people with small children, mm-hmm. and things. But at the same time, we felt the story is important, so we brought it into this visitor centre where people have an exhibition. They can walk around, learn a bit. We have a 15-minute film in a theatre. Again, gives them more background of the monks and how they lived. There's a restaurant here. We do boat trips ourselves. We do cruises going around the Skellig. We don't actually stop. Again, we may be more conscious of families and mm-hmm. elderly people. But also the amount of visitors we get here, it would be too many people for the islands to take. So it's a way of experiencing the Skellig without maybe doing the full thing.
How has Star Wars changed the scene around here?
It has, within the last 2 years, certainly since the first filming for Star Wars 7, and then they've done a lot more filming, which we believe will be used in Star Wars 8 coming up next year. It's certainly opened a new market in that people are coming. We always had visitors looking for Skellig boat trips and things, but it's a different type of thing. People have seen this stunning 3 minutes on the end of Star Wars 7, and it's from a tourism point of view, they've seen that, they say, gee, that's a place we really need to try and get to see. And so a lot of people are coming into the area, and like as a visitor centre, we're obviously, you know, I mean, the more visitors I have, the more people I need here to work.
Mm-hmm.
It's local jobs, it's finance, it's business, and it's positive. I can see a very positive
awesome.
Thing from it. And as we say, there's a Star Wars convention coming up now next weekend, Friday, Saturday and Sunday in London, and Tourism Ireland have invited me to be there because they think it's important from the visitor point of view that we engage with the Star Wars fans.
So I noticed the little Star Wars setup when you walk in. Is there any more Star Wars content in the museum? I haven't gone through it yet.
Well, what we've got so far is about 3 or 4 minutes of behind the scenes of the making of the film of Star Wars 7. But Tourism Ireland are trying to talk to Disney, Lucasfilms about if we can get a little bit more. We're conscious we don't want to do anything that we haven't got permission with, first of all.
Right.
And of course, the Visitor Centre is trying to tell mainly the story of the 6th to the 12th century, hundreds of years before Star Wars. But, but at the same time, cautiously, and we will, I'd say, be adding a bit more,
Do you have any final thoughts about the Skelligs and the importance of them?
Well, as we say, Star Wars 8 now is the next thing, which is sometime next year. And we believe it's a trilogy of films, and Star Wars 9 right. in a couple of years' time will probably also feature. In fact, right. that's where they've done some filming now in Dingle. So these three films for the next 5 or 6 years means we're going to be constantly talking about Star Wars, because the people that are coming into us, we want to talk about Star Wars, and they are fans, and we hope we'll be able to make this part of their holiday and part of the reason for coming to this part of Kerry.
Cool. Do you
want to
tell people how they can find out more about you?
Yes, we have a website, www.skelligexperience.com. Email is skelligexperience@live.com. But visit the website. We're one of the closest buildings to Skellig Michael, where the filming took place. In fact, that's the whole reason the visitor centre was located here, as close as possible to Skellig.
Yeah.
And if people come in here, we'll give them as much interest or information as they're interested in or need. And of course, we do coordinate boat trips ourselves, and boats go from here in the mornings and take people to the Skellig. So,
cool.
Anything like that, I think people will have a reason to come in here.
Yeah.
In conjunction with Star Wars.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thanks for talking to us.
Okay.
Cut the channel, Red 2.
What do you think, Jamie?
Oh, Kate. Kate Dubinko, you planned, you decided what we were going to talk about, you led the episode, you've taught me so much about, and actually, do you know what, you've taught me so much about an area of Ireland that I've never been to, so I would say Bulabus, which means round of applause, Oskelga. Bulabus for Kate Dubinko, you've done a great job, and,
interesting seeing Ireland through someone else's eyes?
Yeah, Ireland through the Dubinko lens, you know. And I suppose, I kind of asked you, is like, has your perception of Ireland changed at all? Like, is it exactly as you wanted it to be and more? And like, I mean, you made a lot of new friends when you got here as well.
Yeah, awesome. Like, I miss it. Like, I want to go back. It's like,
So when you came here, you know, and then when you left... Is it exactly as you wanted it to be? Is it more? Is it less?
Well, yeah. I mean, it was kind of like what I expected, but like in a good way. And yeah, awesome. it's a great place.
Yeah, yeah. So you would recommend people to come and spend money in my beautiful country? I don't know if you or if anyone else realized, I'm quite proud of this little country. And what we've done on an international level, from everything from, you know, sports to movies to, you know, actors and, you know, everything that we do is, you know, I'm very proud of this little place. I think it's not a bad place to have grown up, you know. And as a kid, we were always so happy because we don't have things like snakes or sharks, you know, so we're not going to get bitten by things and we're not going to get, you know, eaten. We've no snakes. No, St. Patrick banished them all. That was his big claim to fame.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah. Interesting. So no snakes.
But yeah.
Well, except for the ones that we see in the pet shop.
I think part of the reason I liked it so much, like, it kind of reminded me of growing up in North Dakota. Mm-hmm. So, especially, like, the more rural settings. Like, it just reminded me a lot of, like, that. Like, the people are kind of similar, like, personalities and... Just, you know, like with the farming, with the agriculture, it reminded me a lot of growing up. So I think that's part of the reason I liked it too.
And I suppose the fact that you'd spent like, 8 months producing a podcast with an Irish person, you kind of almost had an idea of what our quirks were and what our kind of personalities were like. And thank you very much. So it was my plan from the moment just first set recording on Blabba the Hutt. It's like, I'm going to prepare this girl for her inaugural trip to...
And am I an honorary Irish citizen now?
You are indeed, yeah. We'll have to figure out what Dubinko is, Oskelga. It's probably O-Binko.
Nice.
Katie O-Binko.
There you go.
It was from our side, it was a pleasure to have you. You were very easy, actually, to entertain and to kind of point in the right direction, and the moment you set off on the road to Portmagee was probably the scariest moment of my life.
I was
because I felt like
guys.
I was like releasing a I felt like I was releasing a child into the wilderness or something. I was like, this girl has never driven on the left-hand side of the road.
Yeah, that was
she's got this
crazy
monstrous car, and she's got fucking Google Maps telling her where to go.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I was like, I was like, please, just 5 hours, I'm gonna get a text to say I've arrived safe and sound, and then at least she's done 5 hours of driving at this point. Yeah, yeah, because we now, to be fair, we sent you on a longer route.
Oh, you did?
Because it would give you a better give you a lot more places to see, and you know.
Yeah, I took the shorter way back. Did you notice?
Yeah,
but
yeah,
that was also
no,
because
you
ended
said
up
that
staying there longer than they had everything
yeah,
planned.
Yeah.
Anywho.
And you were rushing back for Matt's
yeah.
show. Okay. So Kate, how did you find producing your first episode of Blabba the Hutt?
It was awesome.
Well, when I say producing your first episode, obviously we've had Kate solo
right.
episodes.
Well, that's just me.
But this was you were the driving force behind this yes. episode. You were able to put, you know, all the pieces in to create the overall show.
Yes. I am definitely
maybe something
producer
that...
on my resume. I'm
Pardon?
Putting producer on my resume.
Yeah, do it. I'll sign off on it. I'll give you a reference, no problem at all.
There you go.
Kate, I think we are going to have to get the Dublin Comic Con episode out
yes.
next. But we are hopefully then from... Well, not hopefully, because obviously it's great to have the Comic Con out next. But we have a hell of a lot of interviews to
I
get
know.
Through from Celebration. A hell of a lot of interviews.
We have lots of content.
So we have yeah. great content coming up.
Yes, so stay tuned.
Stay tuned.
Awesome.
Same Blabba channel, same Blabba time.
Anything else in the Blabbaverse? Like,
there's loads gone up over the last few days by way of articles. Let me just click on quickly here and see what we have floating around in the Blabba the Hutt.net. There's been loads happening. From Gary did a great review of the Battlefront Twilight Company, which came out here in paperback. We've obviously mm-hmm. got the Rogue One Roundtable. We've got the initial reactions there. There's a lot going on all the time on Blabba the Hutt, but the best way for people to get involved is literally the social channels is where we have most of our fun. So make sure you are following us on Blabba the Hutt, on across all at Blabba the Hutt across all of the social channels. We would be very, very excited for you to join us and come and have a chat. And don't just follow us and then never talk to us. We don't gain anything. We want to know your thoughts. We want to know your theories. We want you to come and be a part of the craziness that is the social sphere for the Blabbaverse.
So, Jamie, how do you say "May the Force be with you" in Irish?
Okay, so time for a very quick Irish lesson. Okay, so I'm going to say it, and then you're going to say it back to me.
What?
Okay. Yeah, yeah. No, this is happening. You asked the question, Kate. So, actually, when just a little bit of background on this, when Lucasfilm finished the filming of Episode 8, they actually took an ad out in the paper.
Oh yeah,
thanking all the people of West Cork and Ireland for allowing us to use or allowing them to use the backdrop of the Wild Atlantic Way, and they finished it off with "May the Force be with you, Oskelga" in Irish. So it is. Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
Gomé an Fórsalat.
A May of
Fórsalat. G.
What?
G May.
Like, are you saying the?
No, g. Like,
oh,
G-O.
G.
Yeah. May.
May.
On. Forsa. Lat.
Lat.
So, gomé an Fórsalat.
Gomé an Fórsalat. How's that?
on Fórsalat. No. Gomé an Fórsalat.
Gomé an Fórsalat.
Close enough. We'll finish there.
Awesome.
So from all of us here at Blabba the Hutt, go may on force
a lot.
Good job, Bingo.
Awesome.